oldest family church building in Boston today. Now, you're currently sitting in box pews, which may seem like a strange thing to you, but box pews were common in English churches in the 16th and 1700s. The main reason they were built this way here in the city was to keep people warm during the winter. Back in the 1700s, it was impossible to keep a building of this size warm, so families would bring those small metal boxes you can see in our windowsills, called foot warmers, fill them with hot bricks and place them on the floors of their box pews, and they would heat each pew individually, keeping the occupants warm during those cold winter months. Also, to be a member of this church back then, you had to own your pew. This was a closed, private Anglican church, members only, and you were only a member if you owned a pew first. And the pews closest to the front were the most expensive. For example, the ones up here cost 70 British pounds prior to the Revolutionary War. And in today's money, that's about $25,000. So this is a very wealthy, elite Anglican congregation back then. Also, once they purchased their pews, they were allowed to decorate them however they liked. On my right is the Bay Pew, it's upholstered in red, and it's an example of what they all looked like at that point in time. So the walls would be covered in fabric, and the box itself would be filled with furniture instead of the benches that you're sitting on today. However, this church is not famous for its box pews. Instead, it is famous for the events of April 18, 1775. At that point in time, the city of Boston was occupied by the British Army, and General Thomas Gage, commander of the British forces, as well as the royal governor of Massachusetts, had been given the task of quelling the riots and protests occurring here in Boston, preventing the revolution from breaking out. And Gage planned to do this by sending 800 British soldiers in secret to the nearby towns of Lexington and Concord. But they were supposed to seize all the weapons and ammunition that the colonists had been illegally stockpiling there in preparation for a future armed revolt. Now, Gage's plan did not come to fruition as intended. That was because the Sons of Liberty had an extensive spy network here in Boston. They learned of this plan, and they came up with a plan of their own. They would send Paul Revere and William Dawes, their fastest riders, ahead of the British troops so they could warn the militias in both Lexington and Concord, giving them enough time to assemble and defend their two towns and that very important store of weapons. Paul Revere was happy to do this once he received his assignment, but he did have some concerns. He was worried because there were 8,000 British soldiers in Boston at that time, and they were enforcing a 9 p.m. curfew. So Revere knew that there was a good chance that he and Dawes would both be arrested as they left the city after dark, and that no one would be able to deliver that very important message to the militias of Lexington and Concord. So he staged 30 additional patriots over in Charlestown across the Charles River, and they would lead his backup plan. He told them to watch the Old North Church every night for a lantern signal, and if they saw one lantern, then the British troops were moving by land across the Boston Neck. And if they saw two lanterns, it meant that they were taking the shortcut by crossing the Charles River by boat and proceeding on foot from the opposite shore. And that plan was made famous by the line, "What if by land, two if by sea," in Henry Wadsworth Longfellow's poem, Paul Revere's Ride, published in 1860 at the beginning of the Civil War. However, back in 1775, on the morning of April 18th, the Sons of Liberty saw the British lower their boats into the water, knew that was the route they had chosen to take, and that two lanterns would have to be lit in the Old North Church's steeple that night. So they let Paul Revere know, and Paul Revere enlisted the help of two friends to light the lanterns for him, so he could proceed with his midnight ride as originally planned. So while he was rowing across the Charles River, two men, Robert Newman and Captain John Coleman Jr., came in through the front doors and climbed one of those two flights of stairs behind you, and then slipped through a small row of heavy pipeline on the second level. And they climbed all the way up to the steeple in the dark, and once they reached the top, they lit those two lanterns and held them outside the window for just under 1 minute before blowing the lanterns out and coming back downstairs. Luckily for them, the 30 patriots living in Charlestown were very diligent. They were watching carefully. They saw those two lanterns, and then they sent their riders out and warned everyone around the colony of Massachusetts about what was going to be happening in Lexington and Concord the next morning.